get the assembly back together and what we need.
One prayer. That's remember Bill Wilkins and I, and his family. Paul passed away unexpectedly today. He was non-responsive there at the house, and they took him on to the ER and could never revive him. So Paul passed away. They pronounced him dead about 1:30 today. So Bill needs our prayer. Bill's not in good health. Bill's been battling this COPD for a long time. He's very broken today. Just remember that family. The arrangements are incomplete at this time. Jonathan is Paul's son's in Hawaii. Stationed in Hawaii, military. So a lot got to be done to get him home. I do know that he will be brought to the church. It's been one of Paul's requests for a long time. But he will let everybody know through the text, the church text as well. So remember that. Family in our prayers, keep them in prayer. Remember also Steve Tipton. Let's continue to remember him. He's in the Christian Care. Also remember Denny May. And he's in the Christian Care as well. Let's remember him. Friends all were sick. Carrie Edwards, you remember her. She still recovering from her surgery, taking therapy. Anyone have spoken to you?
Heaven remember Greg, he's in the hospital, in the Irwin hospital.
Also, let's remember Fritz Edwards, he called me right from the church. I said Fritz Edwards is in the hospital up in Bristol Regional with gangrene.
Thank you.
testimony. Turn with us to the book of Esther, book of Esther, chapter number 4.
Verse 13, Esther chapter number 4, Esther, the book of Esther is right after the book of Nehemiah, in the Old Testament. All right. Verse 13 of Esther 4. Says, then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, think not thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether hold thy peace at this time, then shalt there an enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whither thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the reading of your word. And I pray, Lord, tonight, God, that you just give us utterance. And Lord, you just get anything, Lord, out of our life wouldn't hinder your word being preached and the demonstration of the power and the Spirit of God. I pray, God, Lord, that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, I know this is familiar scripture to all that reads the Bible and knows the Word of God. And just a little bit of background here. And the book of Esther, Esther was an orphan. Esther, her mom and dad passed away. And if you read in, I guess, the first chapter of Esther, there was a queen named Vashti. And the king Ahasuerus there desired Vashti to come in and dance before him and all the others there at the banquet that he had assembled. And Vashti dishonored the king by not doing what he had requested. So basically, the queenship was taken from her, and it was desired of the king that to let fair young virgins to come before the king, and so here is mentioned in chapter number 2 of a first of all a man named Mordecai. And Mordecai was the son of Jair, the son of Shammai, the son of Kish, a Benjamite, who had been carried away from Jerusalem with a captivity, which had been carried away with Jehoconiah, the king of Judah, from Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, and carried away. And he brought up Hadashah, that is Esther. That would be his uncle's daughter. It says, his uncle's daughter, for she had neither father nor mother, and maiden, and the maiden was fair and beautiful, whom Mordecai, when her father and mother were dead, took for his own daughter. It goes on to say, so he came to, as it came to pass that when the king's commandment and his decree was heard, when many maidens were gathered together into Susa in the palace, to the custody of Haggai, that Esther was brought also into the king's house, to the custody of Haggai, keeper of the women. So Esther found favor there in Haggai's eyes, and then later on she found favor in the king's eyes, and the king desired her to become his queen. But there was a man named Haman there that was under the king, and Haman he made a decree and had the king sign it that to to have all the Jews destroyed, and how that all this was heard, and Mordecai was told Mordecai, but in the meantime, the Bible speaks about a time where Mordecai heard about the two doorkeepers, the chamberlain of the king, how they desired to kill the king. And Mordecai let that be known, and he stopped that from happening. And nothing was ever done about it, nothing was said about it, but Mordecai basically saved the king's life. And so the story goes on to tell that how that Mordecai heard about the decree, heard about the how that they sought to kill all the Jews. And so Mordecai, he had to send messages by a messenger to Esther. She was withdrawn from her family or anybody from the outside. And so he was still able to communicate through messengers, but he let Esther know. And so when he let her know about it, the Bible says here in chapter number 4, it says that, and backing up there in verse 10, and Esther spake in the hatchet and gave him commandment unto Mordecai, and all the king's servants and the people of the king's providence, do know that whosoever, whether man or woman, shall come into the king and to the inner court, which is not called, there is one law of his to put him to death, except such to whom the king shall hold out the golden scepter that he may live, but I have not been called to come in to the king of these 30 days. And they told Mordecai Esther's word. So basically the way it, when one would think of a queen ship, it would be, thinking about a lifestyle of luxury, but in those days it was a lifestyle of confinement, and you didn't go to the king unless you were asked for of the king, and so it was another way of imprisonment, I guess, in a way, because she couldn't see her family or talk to her family or anything like that, So Mordecai was asking Esther to go in and talk to the king about this matter of this decree. And she sent the message back that, you know how it is, that the law that's given, if I go in unannounced, I could be killed. And how that the law is, whoever goes in to speak to the king unannounced will be put to death. That's the king's rule. So Mordecai come up. He came back with this answer. And this is what I want to focus on tonight. This is what I'm interested in. Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, "Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews," because you're a Jew too, right? "For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place." So if you don't do nothing, then the deliverance comes from another place. You know why? Because there's a God's people's promised people. Amen? And it says here, deliverance arise to the Jews from another place, "but thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed." Just because you are in the king's house doesn't mean that you're exempt from this decree, basically what he was saying. He said, "You'll be destroyed in your father's house." And basically what he was saying is her father's house would be including him and all of her relatives, right? And he goes on to say, "Who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" So basically what he's saying is, you've been brought to this kingdom. You've been put in the position that you're in for such a time as this. And if I had a thought tonight or a title, it would be "For Such a Time as This." Now, you think about the predicament she was in, because if she would, she knowing if she goes in unannounced and the king does not raise his sepulcher to her, that he hold out the sepulcher to her, then basically she could lose her life. So she had a choice to make to forget about being at the king's house, being a queen, forget about her position, and forget about herself and think about others. Not only by her not doing anything, you know, could affect, you know, her, but it'd affect everybody around her. And even as Mordecai said, that deliverance could still come, you know, from another place. But God has put you, Esther, in this place for such a time as this. Now, I don't believe in coincidence. I believe God is in control of everything. Amen? I don't believe God puts us in places by coincidence. I don't believe that God's like, uh-oh, I didn't mean for that to happen. But I believe there is a purpose for all of our lives. And Romans 8:28, for all things work together for the good to them that love God and are called according to His purpose. I don't think it's coincidental that you do what you do for a living. You might have had a desire to do that particular of a occupation, but I believe that God wants you and God puts you where you belong and where God wants you, where He can use you for such a time as this. And everything that we face in every circumstance in the time frame is up to God. And God knows exactly what's going to happen. And God knows where to put us, where we can be used of Him, amen, for that particular time frame. I've looked and looked back on my life and seen how that I would have never met people where I have been unless I had been in a hospital. I would have not have seen and experienced the situation or been able to help people by the help of God, because that's the only way we can help people is by the help of God. Amen? We feel like we're doing good, but hey, it's God that's helping us in order to help somebody else. Does that make sense? Because we can't do nothing. We can't even help ourselves, much less somebody else. But our help comes from the Lord. Therefore, since our help comes from the Lord, we're able to help somebody else. But situations that we get in, we may think, my goodness, what a predicament I'm in. But not only, you know, we can look at it as boy, this is a hard situation. This is a hard time to be in. But if we look at it like God has put me here and in this position for such a time as this to bring glory and honor to His name and to help somebody else through Him. Amen. Now, I know throughout all of our lives, in our Christian lives, we have been in situations like that. But not every situation we think in our mind, and it's easy to forget that God can get glory out of the situation for such a time as this. But in order to be usable and to be helpful for such a time as this, fill in the blank, whatever time it is, we need to be prepared for such a time as this. That's why it's very important to have a walk with God and to know the Word of God and to have the Word of God rolled upon the tables of our heart for such a time as this. Because that's the only way you can ever help somebody is through the Word of God, through the help of God. In the Word of God is instruction for such a time as this. Whatever time it is, there's instruction in the Word of God. And if God's people don't know what God's Word's saying, how can we help somebody for such a time as this? All right, in the time we're living in right now, there's a lot of people searching for answers. Amen? For answers, for hope, for peace, for direction. God can use every one of us tonight for such a time as this if we are willing to be used of God. Amen? But we've got to know God's Word and know what God's Word is saying. And in order to know what God's Word is saying, we've got to be reading the Word of God with a spiritual mind, because God's Word is spiritually discerned. Amen? It's time that we step up to the plate as God's people, amen, and be used of God for such a time as this. Not afraid of persecution, because it could very well happen. Amen. She wasn't afraid. She had to lay aside some selfish motives before she went into the king. Amen. She had to lay aside of the fear and thinking, well, this could be it for me. So do I go or do I stay? What's worth it? What's worth more to me? Her people was worth more to her than her own life. That's why she went on in. But what she didn't realize was that not only did God put her in that place for a reason, God was making provision on the other end. When God has put you in a position, in a situation, He has never and will never put you out on a limb and leave you. God will always make a way when there is no way. Amen? If it's God's will for you to face it, God will give you the grace, the ability, the knowledge and wisdom and the peace and the courage to go through with whatever His will is for your life. You believe that tonight? Amen. Every one of us, God has given you the grace and the strength to face everything, whatever it may be in your life, in your career, at work, your job. You know, and it don't matter what job it is, every job is stressful. I'd say at a pie factory, there's some stressful days. I guarantee it. So, there's some stress somewhere along the way. No matter what it is. But you know what gets us through the stress? You know what gets us through the times where we want to quit, when we want to give up? When we remember not only us, but we remember those around us. And we remember not only does our decisions affect us, but our decisions affect everyone around us. So by our decision, God has put us in places of our work, or it might be even a sickness that God has put upon you, and you wonder, why has this happened, Lord? Why me, Lord? And maybe Esther. You know, Esther was dealing with a lot while there at the king's house. She had lost her family. She had lost her mother and her dad. Mordecai, a cousin, became a father figure to her. And how that he had took her in as his own daughter. And the only father that she knew was Mordecai. And she was dealing with that. And bereavement can be detrimental, and bereavement can become depressing. And no doubt she was dealing with all this all at once, and then all of a sudden all this comes up that, hey, you've got to do something. So she had to lay aside all that, all this stuff about her, and forget about her and think about others, all the Jews in the land. And so she went in. And the king held out his scepter. And she was able to find grace in the eyes of the king. And so, as the story goes, here Haman, he was asked to come to the banquet that the Queen Esther had requested. And Haman thought he was going to be moved up, promoted. And then that night before the banquet, the king couldn't sleep. Now remember, Mordecai saved the king's life without the king knowing it. Everybody had forgotten it, but there was a book of remembrance. The book of Chronicles. So he couldn't sleep, so he said, have them read to me. So they read the part where Mordecai saved the king's life. He said, what was done for this man? Nothing. And he said, who's outside? Well, about that time, Haman. See, Haman despised Mordecai because Mordecai didn't bow to him and reverence him like he wanted. He despised him. He wanted rid of Mordecai. So Haman had built gallows to hang Mordecai. So he was coming actually to speak to the king on that matter, having Mordecai hanged. But before Haman could even speak a word, he said, what should be done for the man that brings honor to the king? He thought it was of himself. Oh, he said, well, he said that the royal apparel be brought unto the king, which the king uses to wear, and the horse that the king rideth upon, and the crown royal which is set upon his head. Let this apparel and horse be delivered to the hand of the one of the king's most noble princes, that they may array the man with all whom the king delighteth to honor, and bring him on horseback through the street of the city. Boy, he had thought of this, hadn't he? And proclaim before him. He was thinking all along it was about him. Thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delighteth to honor. Then the king said to Haman, make haste and take the apparel and the horse as thou hast said, and do even so to Mordecai the Jew that sitteth at the king's gate. Let nothing fail of all that thou hast spoken. Boy, Haman, buddy, he had a different attitude after that, didn't he? And so that was done, and then the banquet, which Esther revealed unto the king about what Haman had done and what Haman wanted to do to the Jews. And so the story goes on that it was also told the king that Haman had built gallows for Mordecai. So the story ended of how Haman was hanged in his own gallows and the Jews were saved. So, for such a time as this, it might get complicated, but there's never a situation that's too complicated for God. Amen? Situation might get so complicated you can't even really know how to pray about the situation. You ever been in situations like that? Lord, I don't even know where to begin. God, I don't even know how to explain this. It's so complicated. But God knows. God already knows. And when we ask Him to help and intervene. Now let me back up. I missed a part there. Between the time when Esther was speaking through a messenger to Mordecai and the time where she actually went in to talk to the king, she sent word back to Mordecai, you have my brothers and sisters pray for me and fast and pray. Let me say, prayer changes things. they were praying for her as she was not only making the right decisions, but as she was going through with the decision. She was following through with the decision. So she went in, and while she was going in, I believe as people of her own people, the Jewish people were praying for Esther. Amen? And so I don't believe it was coincidental. I don't believe the king just showed favor because Esther was the queen, because it was obvious that the king didn't show favoritism, especially when Vashti dishonored him, right? So there was no, he was a very harsh man. He was a very strict man. And so all this was taken into account before she went in. But I believe he saw the look on her face that she was serious about coming in there. And I believe he knew that she was well aware of what she was doing. And I believe that there ought to be a sense of sincerity in every child of God's face as we do the work of the Lord, as we live for God, and as we make a difference for such a time as this. Every one of us make a difference. You say, you don't know what situation I'm in, you can still make a difference. You said, I don't see it, preacher. You might not see it, but God does. Amen? You say, well, you don't know the people I'm dealing with. You don't know the people that are against me. You don't know this. You don't know that. I might not, but God does. God can make a way when there is no way. Not only did Jesus say that He was the way of salvation, but He's a way maker in every area of our life. Amen? For such a time as this. I wonder if there was a time that Esther wanted to die. See no hope of really her future. Thinking, well, there's no use. Mom and Daddy's gone. Why should I even live any longer? What good could come out of my life now? I've lost the best two friends of my life and closest friends in the world to me, and the ones that's loved me the most. How can anything good come out of my life from this day forward? The Bible don't record that, but I would dare say that happened. Because as if a lot of you that have lost your mom and dads, you have thought there's no way that I could ever rejoice and be happy again of losing my parents. But no doubt she was faced with that. But God blessed her, and God had favor on her life for such a time as this. That's the message tonight. Every head bowed and every eye closed tonight. God has spoke to your heart and situation you may find yourself in, decision making. You might have come out of a situation, come out of a storm, and you thought, how in the world can anything have come good of that situation? But I believe that there is nothing coincidental to God, that God puts us where we belong, especially when we're praying God's will to be done in our life. Maybe we think we need to be somewhere else, but God has allowed you to be where you're at for such a time as this. I believe God puts us not only in occupations, but I believe God puts us in churches. God puts us in schools and wherever God's will for us to be in. I believe God puts us in places for such a time as these. But here's the thing. We've got to be willing. We've got to be obedient to God's will to be productive. That God wants you to, God wants us to be used, but if we're not willing to be used, then we hinder God's work being done. Does that make sense? We've got to be willing. We've got to be obedient to the will of God for such a time as this. We can't rebel against God to be used for such a time as this. Heavenly Father, we love You. We thank You, Lord, for Your Word tonight. I pray that You'd help us. Help us all, Lord, tonight to be willing and obedient and usable for You in every situation that You allow us to be in. We thank You, Lord, for the strength and the grace and the courage You give us, Lord, to bring honor and glory to Your name. We're not running on our own strength and our own ability and our own knowledge and our own wisdom. But God, it comes from You. It all comes from You. So when we try to make excuses of our limitations, help us be reminded of the unlimited God who is calling us to the task. God, help us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.